I'm a third-year PhD student. My name is Elena Kakaulina, and I work with Bruno Lopez and Alexi Metter. So I will start sharing my screen. Working with Bruno Lopez and Alexi Metter, and part of the top Lagrange team and Matisse Consortium. I'm working on the protoplan 3 disks and studied with Matisse especially, mid-infrared band. And today I'm gonna talk about the first Matisse L-band observations of the protoplan 3 disk around HT17918. And I'm gonna talk if the inner 10A region of this disk is rich in carbon dust particles. So first of all, the protoplan 3 disks are actually the remnants of star formation process, and they are located around the young stars. And here on the schematics, you see the protoplanetary disk up to 100 AU is the standard size for the protoplanetary disk. It can be larger, of course. And these different distances from the star emit different wavelengths. And what's important to say is that part of this protoplanetary disk will be accreted on the star, and part of this disk will be used to form the planets around the star. And to remind you that our solar system has most of the planets within this 10 AU region, and that's what is most interesting region for us. And as you can see, this region emits at mid-infrared. Of course, if we're talking about planets, we need to talk about the materials they're made of. Most important is the solid materials which are comprised in the core of these planets. And in this picture, you see the silicates in the spectra of young stellar objects in the disks of those. They were ubiquitously found in disks due to the prominent feature around 10 micron. I just remind you that silicates are rocky substances which are also profoundly found in the Earth's crust, and they're dominated by silicate oxygen bonds. But what about the other solid species, like for example, solid carbon, and in which solid form we can find this carbon in this 10 AU region, in the planet forming region. Just to motivate you to say some things about carbon or carbon dust in general. Carbon is a major, a fourth major element in the universe among oxygen, hydrogen, and helium. And also carbon dust, or carbon in the carbon to oxygen ratio, determines the composition of planets and exoplanets and their atmosphere. Also carbon grains have the big surfaces, and they allow to form the organic molecules. And also a carbon dust can be very small, in size of nanograins, and these nanograins are well coupled to gas, which will allow us to say about the disk geometry. So carbonaceous dust come in different forms and shapes, and here are the examples of this carbonaceous species we can find in the protoplanetary disks, such as fullerenes. It's a spherical shaped species, PH, which stands for polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which the atoms of carbon in the form shaped in the form of rings, as you can see. There also can be bigger conglomerates of these pHs, which will be linked by the aliphatic or aliphenic bonds. And so there are also diamonds, amorphous carbon, which doesn't have the structurized arrangements, and hydrogenated amorphous carbon. These carbonaceous nanograins have the particular spectral signatures or features, how we call them, around at the specific wavelengths. So here in this plot, you see different emission coming from the intermediate mass young stars in blue and the solar mass young stars in pink. And here is a particular my star or my object of interest, HC179218. And in red, I depicted the infrared aromatic infrared bands, which I emitted different. The most prominent, I think, in L band is 3.3, and the aliphatic bands, which are pointed in green. And there is also the schematics for you to distinguish that aromatics are indeed look like rings, and aliphatic and phoenix, they are just like chains of carbons, which are connected with single or double bonds. So these emissions were detected or were described in CO Catal 2017. And the thing is that we always could detect, or we not always, but we could detect this carbonaceous nanograins in the disks thanks to this instruments, NACO and Vizier instrument, which were installed at the VLT, Very Large Telescope in Chile. But we could never, up till now, locate the nanograins within this 10AU region. But recently we built the new instruments such as MACHIS, which I showed, which will be able to locate the nanograins in this 10AU region. So MACHIS at the VLTI, a Very Large Telescope interferometer in Chile. You see the picture, the 3D view of MATIS, and there's a laboratory which is installed under the ground at the VLTI. MATIS combines four beams at three different bands from 3 to 13 micron. And since it's interferometer, it has a high angular resolution, and also it's a spectrometer which can have a spectral resolution up to 4000. Since it's interferometer, as I said, the main observable of it, of the interferometry, is visibility or the contrast of the fringes V. So here is the real fringes which were detected during the commissioning of MATIS. The fringes obtained by observing Betelgeuse in N, M, and L bands. And just for you to know that if we observe some object and its visibility is one, we will say that it's unresolved, meaning that it looks like a point-like source. And if visibility is zero, when the contrast of fringes is zero, we say that the object is fully resolved. One also important thing about the interferometer is that we can change our angular resolution by changing the distances between the telescopes. So in Chile, to the VLTI, we can change the distance up to 150 meters. So my object, HC179218, is intermediate mass young star with a temperature around 10,000 Kelvin at the distance 266 parsec. It's in the transitional state. It has transitional disk, meaning that it has a deficit around in the infrared band, as you see here. And we also know, as I showed you in previous slides, that it has some carbonaceous features. It was detected with NACA instrument. But again, we don't know where this. And in 2018, there was a study on this object, and Kluska et al. Confirmed there is an unusually hot inner emission depicted in blue, which is up to 10 AU from the star. And there is also a ring-like emission, which is located at 10 AU. So this is the image. Actually, it's not a reconstructed image, just the blue part was reconstructed. And the orange is just a model image. So I used two models, this object. I used a temperature gradient model, which I built. And this temperature gradient model has a temperature radial profile and surface density profile, meaning that we split the ring or the disk around the star into the infinitesimal rings, which will emit as a black body, but attenuated by the emissivity factor, which comes from due to the optical depth, which is pointed to the observer. So this is the schematics of this disk around the star and the infinitesimal ring at the distance r. So in this slide, you see the result of my modeling, which is, was very tedious. I used different interferomic bands, not only Matisse. As you see, Matisse data is very resolved. So as I told you, it's already 0.2, the visibility. And it's also, it's only single shot, so we have only visibility at six baselines. And it's L band data. And there is MIDI in N band, Pioneer in H band, and the broadband SCD, which I used to model this object. And what I confirmed is that it indeed has unusually hot extended inner emission, up to 10 AU and with 1700 Kelvin. And that it's at 10 AU, there is a ring-like emission, so completely different emission. And also that the inner disk, the inner region is dust depleted, meaning that it has a very low mass. So there is a result of my modeling, infrared continuum modeling. As I said before, to characterize, to build the best fit, we need to have two different components which will have different temperature. The first component, the inner component, is very hot, up to 10-ish AU. And the second component is at equilibrium temperature, there's a temperature of equilibrium and at the 10 AU and has a completely different geometry, ring-like. So, but the question still remains, how is it possible that we have this very, very hot extended inner region due to what? So in collaboration with Natalie Sart, Emilia Bart, and others, the colleagues from Paris, we built, we characterized these grains. And this is a plot which you see has different grain sizes from 0.4 nanometer to 10 nanometer, which is different temperature distribution. a different temperature, which is emitting a different distances from the star. And this red line, it's a model temperature 1700 Kelvin. And you see that depending on the size, the temperatures of the grains can indeed stay around 1700 within this 10 AU region. So what we did to include this and to locate, we need first to like, we also need to locate this nanograins. So I, again, with the same collaborators, they provide us with a template of this nanograins, which has aromatic and aliphatic bands. And since we already had a good infrared continuum best fit, we could put on top of it a ring-like emission of this nanograins. And by changing the size of this ring of this nanograins, we could simulate the visibilities of this object. So here in this slide, you see the observed L-band Matisse data visibilities and simulated from coming from the best fit model. I fix the outer radius of this ring at 80 AU and we write the inner radius of this nanograin ring. And due to that, we could already rule out some of the positions of this ring. So meaning that the string cannot be very very close to the star because the visibility shows the emission kind of bump at 3.3, which is not represented in the data. But unfortunately, we cannot say more because it's low resolution data and it looks like it's within error bar, so we cannot really tell where exactly these grains are located. But if the situation will get better, so if meaning that they, first of all, will be allowed to travel to Chile to observe, and second of all, if they fix Matisse and they and will be able to observe in medium resolution, they say it will be able, we will be able to observe in December sometime soon. Yes, not very soon for me, but yeah. So here you see this synthetic medium resolution Matisse visibilities. And again, if we had these observations, or we will have these observations, we will be able to locate this presence of this nanocarbonaceous nanograins within 1 AU. And we also will be able to distangle aromatic and infrared bands and study the properties of those bands. So in summary, so to summarize, I presented the first study, which was aiming to detect carbon solid particles in the inner region of protoplanetary disk. The nanograins are indeed present in this 10 AU region. The existing low resolution data doesn't rule out the presence of these carbon grains. And in future, we hope that medium resolution data will constrain the location of the grains at the level of 1 AU. And we will tell about the physics of interaction and replenishing mechanism of those nanograins. So for the future of my thesis, the future projects is, will be to investigate the contamination from the atmosphere. And of course, maybe not with me, but we'll perform the observations with small baseline and medium resolution. And we will study this subject better. Thank you. So thank you for listening. Now I will ask answer to the questions. So did you consider, so Florentin Mio, did you consider the presence of gas in the inner region, so very specific types of dusty grains? So we were thinking about it, but in my model, I can only put the opacities of the of dust. And it's actually built, as I said, the temperature gradient model is, every ring is emitting as a black body. So when I guess if we use gas, it won't be black body emissions. So that's why I didn't develop such model, because it took me already a long time to develop this one and study and to find the best fit model. Thank you. Anders should scroll down. Okay. This is the. There are no other questions.